First of all, welcome. Who hasn't been here before? Raise your hand. Who has never been to a first hot topic? David Gross. Okay. Anyone else? Who hasn't received? You are? Hi, Gary. Did both of you guys receive my email?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody not receive email?
The rabbi,
yeah. Clearly, he didn't receive email, even though I sent it to Fred.
We'll get it to
Fred.
Right. So, then there's really no need to sign in, because if you're getting my emails, then you'll know for the next one. Find out about
Larry,
can
you hold the mic up?
I can hold the mic up higher. Okay. So welcome, first of all. This is probably the coolest part of the evening, because we've got a lot of topics we're going to cover. And you can see we've got an august panel of 9 people who are going to at least start the conversation going. But before we do that, you know our resident Byron Cohn is out of town on a cruise. But, where is he? Eli. He was very diligent, Larry Sumner, and he gave Eli a joke to tell.
You can tell us more than Eli.
No, he needs to like the
joke.
This is a joke. Eli's
not a joke. You don't look like Larry.
Please.
That's here, that's why.
Turn off your phones, everyone.
Thank you.
On a lighter note. This joke is from Larry, and I hope you enjoy it. Frank Sinatra used to... Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay.
Speak
the Fontainebleau Hotel was the location of Frank Sinatra's show, and that was back in the 50s and 60s. After one of his shows, his manager joined him in his dressing room and said, Frank, that was a great show. I really wish you would give that show to my mom's condominium. So Frank decided he'll go and he'll give the show to this condominium. He went there and he brought the house down. It was wonderful. There was applause all over the place, except for one little old lady in the first row. She was just sitting there. So he went over to her and he asked her, "Man, didn't you like the show?" "Yes, yes. It was wonderful. It was the best show I ever saw." So he thought to himself and he said, "Well, was my song selection good?" "Yes, yes, everything was great." And then he asked her, "Do you know who I am?" "Well, if you really want to know who you are, see that nurse over there? She tells everybody who they are."
Thank you, Eli. You opened work. I'm trying to figure this out, because no matter what I do, you somehow or other get about 75 people who show up. So I just did a quick count. It's kind of interesting. Thank you, Joy. So tonight's topic, as you probably all know, is about the point of view of conservatives, liberals, and independents on a number of key issues. Now I bet you all know.
Eli?
Help. And if I talk like this, can you hear me?
Did you like it, Phil?
It worked better.
Does this work any better?
No.
Now we got it.
One of the things about conservatives and liberals and independents is the similarity to what they want for the world. If you read what I wrote, I actually found some definitions in a high school newsletter. And what it says is we all want the same things in life. We want freedom. We want the chance for prosperity. We want as few people suffering as possible. We want healthy children. We want to be crime-free. The argument really is, how do you achieve that? To paraphrase, liberals...
Can you talk into the mic, please?
No. Liberals believe that government should help support those goals. And conservatives seem to think that the government should empower people to be able to do that sort of thing, in a nutshell. With that in mind, let me introduce our panel. And ironically enough, to my left...
Starting. Where's your baseball cap?
I'm from Paul.
Steve Paley, a dyed-in-the-wool something from communist record. Harry Rosen, and Arnie Bennett. So you guys want to just raise your hand. They will be representing the liberal point of view. The so-called independence, Chris. And I use that advisedly because they may or may not have come across to you as independents, but they say they are. John Cubs, Leonard Bolt, and Fred Kaufman.
Thank you.
And the anti-communists, Howard Winsell, and the two-for-one combination of Rita and Larry May. So the way we're going to work this tonight, and they've been briefed that they have to be briefed, is that I will ask from a myriad of topics. We actually have enough to go for 4 or 5 days, quite literally. One of them to answer their point of view on that particular subject. And hello, Rabbi. The particular subject we're going to start with is about the energy issue, the energy policy in the United States, the cost of oil, or gasoline, and why it's going up, and whether or not the political system can really make a difference. So cheered by this, I'm going to ask Rita May to begin on her point of view as a conservative about what's going on now. There's a microphone you can pass.
Can you hear me if I speak very loud?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
All right. No. Stand.
They've been told they have 30 to 60 seconds and then we give them 100.
All right, regarding the cost of oil, which seems to be rising.
Is this working?
Yes.
Turn it on.
That will help.
Hello?
Yes.
Okay, sounds good. Regarding the cost of oil, obviously I believe that we should do more drilling. I think we have a lot of oil in the United States that we're not tapping. I think we need more, not regulation with the oil prices, but I think we need the president or Congress or whoever to get more involved with the tax default credits, the tax credits that the oil companies are getting, the high taxes on the oil. Maybe switch that out with lowering the prices. But I think it's really the cost of oil. It's being manipulated by the Middle East. There could be a chance that it could go up to, some people predict, as much as $400 a barrel, which would completely destroy our economy. Do I still have some more time?
Yeah, another 3 seconds.
Another 3 seconds. So now, this has happened before, and we've always blamed the administration before. We're not blaming the administration now, so it doesn't really seem fair to me that when the oil prices rise during the Republicans or the conservatives, everybody wants to take the congressional hearings as they wanted to do with Bush. But now that the oil prices are high, we've decided that it's really nothing that the government can do about it. So.
Great, Rita. Thank you very much. Leonard Wolf. The topic is the price of oil, energy policy, and what can the politicos do about it?
Well, it's obviously you all recognize that it's a most difficult situation for the simple reason it's not simple. If we're talking about pipeline, that was supposed to come from Canada down, which has been referred to, I think they call it the Keystone Pipeline, even if that came into effect, it would take a few years before the pipeline was finished. We need to address the problems currently. And as to how we're going to do it when we ourselves are going to probably be in need of it should something break out shortly this year in the Middle East. And right now, today, we saw on the news that both Britain and the United States are going to go into their reserves to try to ease up the current policy. There are a myriad of ways of addressing it, not necessarily all constructive, but there's a lot that none of us are privy to and just don't get to see. So we have to be very discerning as to how this is going to play out, and accordingly take that into consideration when we have to cast our deciding factor.
Thank you. Okay, so far, our panelists are adhering to the guidelines. So, cheered by this, Arnie Bennett.
Hi. Here's your... Everybody hear me okay? Hear me now?
Yes.
I think the first important point is why are gas prices up? Why are gas prices up and going up? It has nothing to do with the last President Bush or Obama. It's not within their control. We must remember that as the economy grows, especially in China, they're putting thousands and thousands more cars on the road. Oil is going to move up. Oil is a commodity. They manipulate this commodity very easily. When you own airlines, when you have trucking companies, they have to buy derivatives. They have to look for the future. They're literally buying insurance for what might come. It's a very manipulated commodity. It always will be. As far as what's happening in the Near East, Far East, this is a cyclical thing. Every time something happens, the oil goes up. But remember, it's a commodity that no party can control. It'll reach its crescendo, and then it'll settle down.
Thank you, Arnie. Does anyone from the audience want to comment about this? Okay, let's start with Dave Rosen. Dave, you may have to come up here and use the microphone. And Mac, you might as well line yourself up. Who else wants to talk?
That's right. The statement that oil is a commodity was the key. Commodity prices vary depending on the anticipation of the future supply. This government has made it clear that the United States is not going to expand their future supply of oil and coal, and in anticipation of them not expanding, and working on the philosophy of hope. And let's hope that we can get green fuels and exotic things that are untried and throw money at it. The whole world has realized that the United States'
future for more oil
is limited. When the futures are limited, the price goes up because commodities are sold as futures in the future. That's one of the main reasons. China right now is on the downslide. They're not bringing in oil, but they're actually, the economy has slowed down considerably. It's not world use. It's not world use. It's the future anticipation.
The fact of the matter is that we have 3% of the world's oil. We consume 25% of the world's oil. Now, anybody can do the math. We are constantly going to be in need of oil if we stay this way. It was so 25 years ago, and it'll be so 25 years from now if we don't do anything about it. And the answer is we've got to get off oil. It will be costly at first, absolutely. We will increase the price. We may pay as much as $10 a gallon for oil, but we've got to get off the oil. And the way to do that is to increase the price of oil now and use that excess, those excess funds, for natural gas and other.
No, you can't get hurt. Come on up here. Anyone else want to go after Mr. Z? Okay, this will be our last on this subject.
All I can say is that we have heard from administration after administration that we have to have alternate fuel. As soon as that happens, the price starts of oil starts to come down. Then we don't do a damn thing about it.
Why?
But there's no answer to that. The administrations then say, oh, we got that bit off our head. But natural gas is an item that can be used.
Immediately.
And we could bring our prices down. They have certain cars that can run on it. But the great majority of them can't. They have to be adapted to it. The reason they're not doing it is because they love this. They love the prices to go up and up and up, because what happens? Oil companies make a fortune. The people on those stock markets make fortunes. So therefore, the administrations, all Republican, Democrat, doesn't make any difference, they're all the same. And they do nothing to get alternate fuel and alternate ways to run machines. Until that happens, nothing's going to happen. It'll just keep each administration over my whole lifetime has said the same thing. We must bring the prices down. Alternate fuel hasn't happened.
Larry May? Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't see your hand.
I'm just going to make a couple of comments. One was the fact that we need to exploit what we have. And as the gentleman before me just mentioned, we have a lot of gas. Well, that's not being tapped. Right before Congress, this went yesterday, the bill was shot down. And this was the bill to expand the number of natural gas filling stations so that these could be built and the trucks would be able to refill. And it was shot down because the vote, I think, was 54, and then when people saw that it was not going to pass, then it dropped down to 51, so they didn't get it, and they needed, I think, 60 votes for it. So, and that's the problem, part of the problem that's occurring, is that nobody wants to put their neck out on this whole thing. They'd like to keep things going the way they are. There are a lot of lobbyists right now that are the coal lobbyists.
Chu, the director of energy, had said that he wanted to get the price of gas go up so that we would be dependent upon solar energy. And now he's retreated from that statement, saying that no, he doesn't agree with that anymore. But he did make that statement. So there's a dichotomies all over regarding this whole issue. But we're not going to. We're not going to get any place unless we exploit what we have.
Okay. Thank you very much. We've got three panelists who are itching. Let's start with Larry Mejia's hand up first.
The United States uses 20 million barrels of oil a day. 10 million of those we buy from as foreign oil. Okay? If we have 885 billion barrels of recoverable oil in the United States, which is 3.5 times what's available in Saudi Arabia. If we were able to do the full production that we can do, okay, up to 10 million, okay, and what's in from Canada, which we can do, we would never need another drop of foreign oil. Okay. many people remember when AT&T came out with the video phone? Okay? How many years has it been since then that we now have the capability to, through computers, see somebody else on the other line? It's only been probably, what, 50 years? Okay. The same thing is going to happen with our energy. You can't switch 60,000 gas stations to natural gas, or to algae, okay. Or, as Mr. Obama's wonderful thing during his campaign, put more air in your tires, okay? Those are the things we have to, we can be the leading country in the world of oil, okay? And it's efficient, it's easy to get, and if natural gas is the solution, where do you get it? You get it when you drill for oil.
Last comment, we'll go on to another subject.
Just to set the record straight, and really set it straight, for the first time in the United States since 1949, the U.S. is a net exporter of gasoline and diesel. First time. The first time since 1949, the United States is an exporter of gasoline and diesel. Now let's talk for a brief second about this phony Keystone pipeline. Anybody know what that is or what it produces? All right, someone knows. But to be very factual about it, all it is a pipeline from Canada to Texas to ship oil overseas. Also, it's a thing called tar sand oil. It's dirty oil. They got to crack the rocks and the tar to get the oil. It costs more money to refine this than to use it. At this time, there are thousands of miles of pipeline in the United States. Thousands of miles of pipeline. Texas alone has 200 of them. This, what they sort of are projecting, this Keystone, is the biggest debacle going. The biggest debacle going.
Why?
Because it costs more to refine it, more energy to refine it than to use it. It's a waste of time. It ships overseas. And the danger of the environment is incredible. Ask the people in Kalamazoo, Michigan. Their lakes are still not clean from spills from this almost 3 years ago. So there is really no, there is no process there that makes it worth our while to use. It's just a mirage.
Can you hear me? I just want to add two quick points. One of which is regarding natural gas, which I've mentioned several times. One of the issues with natural gas is the fact that what I've read, the engines and the trains, planes, trucks would have to be totally converted to run natural gas. And the second thing is the infrastructure for getting natural gas from place to place, which are two major issues. I did read this new technology, which is being worked on right now, called GTL, gas to liquid, which would enable this minimal modification to the engines in order to use it, and also the infrastructure would support it. I think that's one key issue. The second key issue is that I've also read that even in our country, there's a 20% disparity in different locations because of the price of oil, gasoline, and again, it ties back to infrastructure, and also some the refining capacity. So many times we're not really getting a straight story, but you also hear that West Texas crude, which is what we, the $106 a gallon oil, can be used in certain places. Other places have to use the Brent crude, which is $120 a gallon. So there is a disparity even in terms of within our country, the capability of getting the oil from place to place, and also where we refine it.
John, for you.
Thank you, Larry. As a person that is involved financially a little bit with oil, I would say in the next 30 to 40 years, the oil usage around the world will go up an additional 30%. It will go down in the United States, and it will go down in other countries like ours. That's not going to stop the need of oil. Oil is out there. in abundance in the United States. We got all the oil we can possibly. 90% of all oil drilled today is by small independents, and that's where I'm at. What we do have is we drill as independents is all the tax breaks. Okay, I think we know that. That's probably true with most things. And in my opinion, until we get an energy policy, what was it that Kennedy told us? We could go to the moon the next number of years, and we did it. All we have to do is say, and I think our issue is that we do not have public servants, but we have public masters. And we keep voting those public masters in, and we hear it every day on the news. They have to say what they say to be reelected. When this country, I think, was founded, this was a test, wasn't it, as to who and what we were and how free we were going to be. And it wasn't about leaving people in office year after year, decade after decade, even into their 90s. We have to vote that way and make it happen. It's really up to us. But it's there. Oil issues are not going to go away. We're going to go to gas. When oil is drilled, you get anywhere from 5 to 18% of natural gas at the same time that you pull up oil, and there's all sorts of different levels. The pipeline coming in, all that does is make jobs in the United States. And if it was the right type of oil, of course we would use it, and some of it may be, and that we may buy some of it. But it's not the oil that you think of the gas station. It might be of using of plastics and other things. Just a thought for us.
The panel of the audience is sharp tonight. This is really good. Let's go to a different subject. One not quite as controversial. Healthcare is not nearly as controversial as oil prices, is it? The question you need to ask yourself is healthcare a right or an entitlement for the citizens? Does the government have the right to tell women what kind of contraception they have, whether they should have abortions or not, and so on? You know what I'm talking about. Let's hear from our good friend Steve Paley first on this subject. Do you have the microphone? Okay.
Basically, I don't believe the government has a right to tell a woman to do anything at any time, especially about you've all seen some of these local laws, state laws, for example, sonograms, when they have to insert something into the vagina of a woman before they'll give her an abortion. I mean, this is just ludicrous. That's the legal definition of rape, when you penetrate a woman with a foreign object. So as far as anything, government should be out of it, period.
Now, is healthcare a right or a entitlement? Is healthcare coverage a right or an entitlement?
I think you have a right to health care in this country. Yes.
It's both. Red.
Okay, I agree with Mr. Paley on both topics, so I won't go into those. However, I think there's some additional ones. In fact, one I just read in that last day or two, that the Congressional Budget Office just estimated $1.76 trillion for the new health care, for Obama's health care plan, versus $940 billion estimate. So already the cost is going, has doubled. And one of the issues is that the technology is coming along much slower than they thought in terms of electronic health records, electronic medical records. And anybody who's implemented technology knows that many times it costs you more with technology than not, and I'm in technology. So the cost is going to be astronomical. I do feel it's an entitlement. I feel we really have to decide at what level and at what speed we're going to do it. And I think this also ties into the fact that there are hospitals jammed with people who don't have health care. And I know I've heard the situation for 8 days in a hospital, and just tie it up just with a sore throat or, you know, or a cold. And that's not something I think we can deal with. So regardless, it's going to cause a problem unless we do cover people. But the cost is prohibitive, and I think we have to go much more slowly at it. And I really feel that the excess testing and everything else that is done, electronic medical record, will to a certain degree will help with that. be duplicated. But I really think that makes much more progress there, and certainly reducing the amount of testing that takes place. And one more issue is dealing with the immigrant problem, too, because we have the whole issue, too, of the immigration problem inside terms of health care. So that'll probably be another topic, but
be another topic.
That's what we have to address also.
In reference to what Fred said, whatever John or Steve said, I think health care is a privilege, it's not a right. You want health care, you pay for it. No entitlement, you don't get, there's no free ride, there's no free lunch. Hospitals are not loaded the way he says, with people with sore throats and all that. The way the system is, if you don't qualify, you're out of that hospital quick. There's no question about that. Anyway, being in the health business for the last 25 years or so, I've seen all the females were taken care of. There was never a problem. They got insurance. They got whatever maternity care that they needed. It was all paid for if they paid the premium. Very simple as far as that.
Thank you. All right, someone from our audience first. I'll look at you. Anyone want to comment? Otherwise, we have our.
Could I just ask a question of Howard?
Sure.
What happens if you don't have insurance?
Very good. I'll answer it. I'll answer that question for you. You can't afford insurance, and if you're that impoverished not to have insurance, very simple. You go to any hospital if you're sick, and they take care of you. Free of charge. That's the way the system works now. You pay for it out of your taxes. One at a time. I'll answer your question one at a time, but not all at once. There are provisions in place to take care of people who do not have, who cannot afford insurance, or who do not want insurance for whatever reason. That is the biggest problem. You have a lot of people, especially at a younger age, that you ask them if they bought insurance or they want it, they say, no, I'm healthy, I'm not paying for it, no matter what the cost is. So if they are impoverished, and a lot of people are, unfortunately, they can go to any hospital in the United States and get coverage. That is so. In answer to your question, that is so, and that is a fact.
What comment did you say, Howard? It's a privilege. But apparently in jail, if you're in jail, it's an entitlement.
Okay. John Lister, Dr. Lister, come up, please. Because otherwise I'll never hear you.
Okay. I'm not going to get into this argument, I just want to answer Howard, but that's all. However, it depends upon your locale and the tax structure of that locale. If you're in Broward County, what you say is true. If you're up in Ocala, it's not true. And if you're in Alabama or Mississippi, it's definitely not true, although I've never been there.
You've been told.
It depends upon the tax structure of the county, and it's very, very variable. Broward County, what you say is absolutely true. Other counties of Florida, it's not true.
It's true in Alabama.
And Mississippi. Someone else in the audience? Herb? Short story.
Very short. 30-second short.
I have to talk very fast.
A man in Minsk hears that his daughter is getting married in Pinsk. He has no way to get there. He's poor. He looks around and he finds a driver with a dray, a wagon, who will take him there for 2 rubles, which is all he has. He goes and looks at the horse. The horse's stomach is on the ground. He says, I'll never make it. He says, don't worry, we'll make it. Get in the wagon, and the first day, clip, good. The second day, unless they're going downhill, he's walking alongside the horse. The third day, they get to Pins carrying the horse. So the old man says to the driver, look, he said, I came for the wedding of my daughter. You came for the 2 rubles. Why did we bring the horse? The horse is everything in between the patient and the doctor. It's these corporations that send every week you get something from Humana. They are not being, they are trying for your dollar, and they're getting your dollar, and they're adding to the cost. So we're not approaching the problem correctly. Obama had a chance, and he fluffed. Business of having one-on-one where all people go directly and deal directly with the doctor, and that will hold the course down.
I also am one who believes very strongly that as the number one country in the world, it's really amazing that we have such poor health care available to so many people. No health care. To suggest that going to an emergency room is health care, that's not the health care. First of all, the cost is greater. Secondly, what follow-up care is given? Do you think that if you have cancer and you go to the emergency room, they're going to give you the follow-up care? Or if you have a heart attack, they'll stabilize you, but they won't give you the follow-up care. 50 million Americans are without health insurance. That was one of the reasons that since Clinton was in office that we started trying to have a unified national health care program. Number two, having it available to all of our residents, to everybody, not just people buying insurance. And who are insurance companies? They're profit makers. There has to be some degree of monitoring when you're dealing with a commodity such as health care. It's not like you want to control the car industry. Who buys an expensive car, an inexpensive car? You're talking about a basic right that is given to people all over the world. All over the world, it's available. So I frankly feel that this health care plan was needed. One other thing, people who are concerned about costs, it was projected that in the next 10 years, the health care costs in the United States would double. So I think that we needed it, and we passed it, and I think it's going to be a benefit to all Americans.
For the moment, health care comes in different forms. Maybe a lot of us here live in a bubble, and we don't know there are people outside this bubble. And we know where to go right away, but a lot of people, most people, don't know where to go. What I'm trying to understand from my conservative friends is why are they trying to do away very clearly with Planned Parenthood, which protects women, protects men, it teaches them, it reduces abortion, they show them what to do during contraception, how it works, how it doesn't work, and it's self-supporting. Also, the Affordable Health Act, which very few people know about, it's part of Proposition 10. The Affordable Health Act helps these people outside the bubble, helps them greatly. None of us, unless we're on our last breath, is going to walk into a emergency room and expect to get care. So, folks, we have to think outside our own bubble. We're not at all. And it gets more expensive when you become the center of your own universe. Let's stop.
Being in the insurance business, I'm not an insurance agent, but I work for one. And I know what goes on. People call up, they want insurance. Well, they weigh too much. They have high blood pressure. They may have diabetes. You get to a certain age, there is no such thing as no pre-existing condition. My son-in-law just had to get his own health insurance. He was on group before. He's a perfectly healthy man, but he has sleep apnea. So to prevent him from, God forbid, getting a stroke or a heart attack, he uses the mask. Every single insurance, we tried to get insurance for him. Every single insurance company turned him down, except one. And that one rated him up 100%. This is impossible. We just came back from a cruise where we met people from all over the world. And people from England and Canada and France and all these places, these socialist countries that have health care for their people. And they say they cannot believe a country like the United States cannot provide health care for their people. It's unconscionable.
I'm listening to these dissertations on health care and all these individual stories. First of all, you talk about foreign countries with their health care system at no cost. The amount of taxes that they pay individually is astronomical. It costs you money to have health care. If you want to go to the entitlement to have every single person have free health care here in the United States, the cost is astronomical. You will never be able to fund that type of cost. It just would not be. Let me speak, and then you can speak, okay? And the problem is, and all these other things that you brought up, Planned Parenthood, these things got out of hand. This is just a system where money is collected from the government to pay for things that maybe they need, maybe they don't need. But you can go on and on and on, and you will see that this cost can get out of hand.
One more thing, just my last
one. Okay, Jack, sorry. You come up. Rita, we'll get you going.
Hi. Regarding foreign countries, Europe, Germany, France, we have the best health care in the world. Look at statistics today. Any disease for cancer, our rates are the best in the world. And you want to make us like Europe? I have relatives that live in Germany. Do you know what they do with their free health care? They pay on the side for good service. There's no such thing as free health care. You're going to pay for it one way or the other. And the most expensive thing is when something is free. And in addition, do you want the government deciding what you get, when you get, how you get it, what's going on? Now, on another subject, quickly on Planned Parenthood, as a conservative, I don't know any conservatives that are against Planned Parenthood. It's a private organization or a charitable organization. Fine, fund it privately. Give out all the free birth control you can. Do all the abortions you want to do. We don't care. We just don't want the government to do it. We don't want the government to tell you what to do or when you can do it. It's freedom we're talking about, to be able to do what you want. You pay for your own health care, and if it was across states, it would be much more competitive and much cheaper. But right now, there are the state regulations where you can't cross borders with health care. So you can get cheaper health care, and those that can't, I'm sure there's a system in the government to provide for people that can't do their own health care. Well, there would be, but there certainly isn't with this $1.7 trillion bill.
Rita, thanks. Well, I want to point out, while you may disagree with their point of view, what they are amply demonstrating is the conservative principle of the way they think the world should work. So I think we should have respect for that as well. You may not agree.
Well, the best way to decrease the cost of health care is to do preventative care. And if you don't have insurance to go get preventative care, the person's going to end up in the emergency room, extremely ill, extremely desperate, and the cost is going to be 10 times higher. So if we don't have a way of using preventative care for everybody in the United States, we're going to pay more, yes. And we're going to have more people in hospitals and more people in emergency rooms because they didn't have preventative care. Let me tell you something. We know that if somebody has a heart attack, it costs a fortune to take care of them. But if they are able to go to a doctor before they have the heart attack for a yearly checkup and see that there's something wrong on their test, they're going to prevent that heart attack and prevent all the things that go with it that they have to, that have to be paid for. So unless we have comprehensive health care where we highlight preventative care, we are going to have much higher costs. Much higher costs. And that's a very important part.
Just to clarify this, two things, right? By every metric of health care, the United States does not rank very well as compared to other industrialized countries. We're close to the bottom. It doesn't matter what you measure, and that's reality. To say we have the greatest healthcare system right now is insanity. The system is broken. I don't think there's any question about that. The issue is, how do you fix it? The Obamacare will bankrupt this country. It's a disaster. You can't have this type of a national health system without a public option. The insurance companies will rape the system, as they have in the past. There's no doubt about it. The story that this one lady said about her son-in-law, it's an everyday occurrence. So that this business that, you know, insurance is readily available, et cetera, we all have some abnormality, and they measure your risk, and it'll drop you like a bomb. So to say that the system works, it doesn't work. To say that we have the best healthcare system in the world, it's not true. The question is, how do you fix it? Obamacare is not the answer. Probably nothing can work without a public option. Also, the German system does work. They have excellent healthcare, and by most metrics, they do very well. And it's a semi-public one. It's a partnership.
It's a public-private.
Public-private partnership. And it was devised, actually, historically, in 1890 by Bismarck. All right? And he devised it because you had rampant tuberculosis in the coal mines of Germany. And something had to be done. And that system has survived. The first law passed by the German parliament post-World War II was to restore the healthcare system that they had. So obviously it's working. And there's no reason we can't look at other countries to see how to do it. This Obamacare is a total disaster. It's an economic disaster, but also a medical disaster.
Hi, everybody. I think there's a very simple fix to this, believe it or not. A very simple fix. And that is this. We as voters can definitely change what we have now in doing one thing. We have to absolutely demand that those people in Congress have to have the same health care that we have. We are voting pro-Obama, anti-Obama. We have this plan and that plan. As long as they do not live by this plan, we will suffer. Here.
What counts in three groups?
My problem is not with national health care. My problem is who is running national health care. Medicare is a total debacle, the only description for it. It has more fraud than anything we've ever seen. We had people here at Hot Topics telling us about fraud in the Medicare system. Now we're going to reward the federal government and we're going to give them national health care. I say no to that.
There's been a report released just within the last week regarding preventive health care. The report states very clearly that if you test 100 people in order to find one person who may have this problem, you have spent more money doing the test on the 100 people than the cost to try to keep this one person alive. The answer is, for preventive, only test those that are indicative or have a history, not the whole group of people. That's why you keep your costs down, not doing preventive health care for a huge amount of people.
Okay, I think we have done ample justice to this subject, although clearly there's a lot of interest in John. I'm sorry we're gone. The next subject is one that I think is of great importance to our country, which is we're slashing the budget for our military. At the same time, we've kept ourselves as in a position to be a policeman to the world. Is this tenable? You're on, Eric, you're first.
Okay. You know, what's amazing, the real issue is, should we be the policeman of the world? It seems like a very foolish question, because the obvious answer is no. We should not be. I don't know how many of you felt the way I did when we went into Iraq. That was a complete debacle. Why were we in there? We were allegedly in there because of nuclear weapons were there, allegedly. Yet there were inspectors from the UN going on meeting with the United States. We went in there, and how many of our young people lost their lives or are now disabled for life? And how about the Iraqis? How many of them lives were destroyed? We should stop going into countries unless it affects our safety and our well-being. And as far as cutting military, there's no question we should cut within reason. We have to be able to defend ourselves, but we don't have to be part of the budget. Doesn't have to be going into other countries to solve the problem. Should we go into, we went into Yemen? Should we go into, we went into Egypt? Should we go into, right now, which is Syria? Syria? Should we go into Syria? Where does it stop? Should we go into Africa? The answer is no. Most of these wars are frankly civil wars. Why should we pick a side in a civil war?
I, as a conservative, agree that we shouldn't be the national police, or the world's policemen. But in those areas where our national security is affected, we should be very, very actively involved. I'm not a proponent of boots on the ground, but I'm a proponent of high technology and military options outside of just putting a guy in and fighting a war like a gorilla. That's what we're doing. And the other thing is, if we do go into some kind of a war, we go in to do one thing, and that's to win. If we don't do that, we shouldn't go in at all. Right.
As an American independent, I think you've seen a lot of both sides. Simply, we all in this room have the ability to vote whatever we want. If we want health care, we don't want it hidden with 2,300 pages behind our backs. We want to have individuals that we put into office to be servants of the people. How many times do we hear people talk about they're a public servant when they're not? They're a public master trying to get themselves reelected for all of their benefits. That's got to stop. That's where we are on the war. If we don't want war, all we have to do is vote that accordingly. All of this other conversation is just putting a band-aid on the issue, in my opinion, as an independent. We can do whatever we want to do. I don't have a side one way or the other. What does America, 51% of the population, want and vote it that way? But will we ever get what we want with the way that our political system is listed today, and they can be in office for 40 years? They don't even have to disclose what they do. They can go out and find out we're going to start a company with an IPO or whatever, and trade it where we can. It's not right. That's what we've got to fix as our leaders. The rest of this conversation doesn't mean much, quite frankly, to me as an American independent.
My first day in combat, I took an oath to myself that if I ever got out alive, I would pay the taxes, whatever it costs, to maintain a first-rate Army, Navy, and Air Force. And the reason I did is I had studied already 2 years about how we needed to maintain a first-rate Army, because there were geopolitical theories, such as in those years, or prior to World War I, it was he who controlled the heartland of Europe would have control of the world. Then during World War II, it was you had to have a two-ocean navy in order to keep control. Today, we're in a different situation. We have to be discerning. I still maintain that we need a top-line first rate of defense. However, we all remember years and years ago, today it looks like nothing, but never wrong, it deals with waste. $600 toilet seats. The charges for aircraft carriers, which was in the billions, that the military didn't even want. But it dealt with what the politicians wanted for their home base or where the aircraft carrier was going to be built. Today, the method of fighting is not necessarily troops and massive troops. And if you looked at some of the more recent carriers, they're a lot shorter and smaller. And insofar as changing the people who are in there to fortify themselves, believe me, that's a lot of where the core of the problem is. You have to be discerning when we start voting and doing things, because there's no or very little regulation. Regulators turned out to be, in the last decade, honorariums, so to speak. A nice title, but very little, if any, regulation other than what was wanted behind the scenes.
Thank you.
I just have a little personal aside. My son works for a consulting firm in Washington, D.C., and he does a lot of dealing with the United States military. For example, he goes to the Naval War College, which is in Orlando, which I don't know if you noticed, it's not next to the ocean. But at any rate, these generals are still fighting World War II. They're still asking for huge airplanes, for aircraft carriers, for big battleships, and that's not where the war is anymore. It's local terrorism that has to be fought. And they're just not keeping up with the times that they are now. And it's costing us a hell of a lot of money.
I know this conversation that I'm listening to and mentioning about the war. I don't know if we still remember what happened in 9/11 and why we went to war at that particular time. Today, wars are completely different, like it was mentioned. There's no troops on the ground. It's all done with drones. And you talk about expense. Yes, there is expense on certain military items. However, my son is also involved in the military, working, selling a project to the Navy where they use the drones. And they are very cost conscious of what programs they use and what software they use to run these drones to make it all effective. So just say, remember, we need a military, but we just can't get rid of all these people, all the military, and leave ourselves defenseless.
Let's get some of the audience, and then we can come back to you for it. Mac? Enjoy.
The problem seems to be that old men make wars and young men have to fight them. The answer is, have a conscription across the board for everybody in the world over 65. Don't draft a man until the age of 65. You'll see how bad it is.
As you talk about more and more technology, have any of you read a book called Cyber War by Richard Clark? Actually, it is probably one of the most frightening things you'll read. People have the capability of going into those systems, those cyber systems, and instead of the plane going to Baghdad or Beijing, they can make it go to New York. This is the most scary part, and this is where we're not investing money, not battleships, but ways to protect this electronic war we're moving more and more to. And I never hear any discussion about that in the newspaper. I don't hear it from our congressmen. I don't hear it from the administration. And
I just hope it doesn't come true, because the book can give you nightmares.
There's a area that nobody's talked about yet, and that is our young men that are coming back from this war. We have so few that they're sending these young men back again and again and again and again. And the young man that just went out and shot all those people was brain damaged, had had a damage to his leg, and they were sending him back again. They are not taking, four times, they are not taking care of them when they come back. That's where our money should go, to take care of the young men and young women who went out there and put their lives out there for us, and they're not being taken care of. And that is a disgrace.
I just want to mention the points Lee brought up, which I'm going to discuss it also in terms of sovereign security.
Put it in front of you.
Yes.
Put it
can you hear me?
Right,
can you hear me?
Yeah, put it in front of you.
Talk in the top.
Okay. Because I'm in the field, I do a lot of reading and a lot of analysis, and there's some things actually happening now in the federal government or not. Obama did appoint basically someone in charge of cybersecurity. However, once again, and it's individual I've met. Once again, you're back to the issue, the military wants it, this one wants it, and who's in charge, and so forth, which we've heard before. However, the government also, right now, is finalizing for our nation's critical infrastructure, security regulations and controls. And once this is finalized, then every installation, critical infrastructure installation, that's utilities and so forth, we have to bring their security to that standard. And it'll be tested with vulnerability assessment, penetration testing, and so forth. So there is some action taking place. But very critical. We saw what Stuxnet did. And basically, that can happen to any infrastructure. So the point is very well taken. Another point I want to mention, too, is going back to 9/11, was the issue with intelligence. Because we had data all over the place, but data was not being properly linked together, analyzed, and processed and analyzed. And I know there's been some improvement, but there can certainly be a lot more improvement in terms of now of what Google, the massive data they process, for example, there's no reason why we cannot do a better job in terms of our intelligence information, and that's where it starts.
The point that Fred was just touching on about cyberspace and high tech in the military. I'm sure there are many people in the room that know about what I'm about to say, but there are a lot that still do not know about it. In order to live in this technological age, whether it's military or privately, you cannot build anything, any piece of equipment today without rare earths. And we do not have them. China has already corralled 97 point something of the world's rare earths. And they're not all the same. Some are rare earths for drones, some are rare earths for everything. Your computers, your cell phones. If anybody wanted to go into a business, it would be collecting all of the used ones. It would be a lot less expensive to get these rare earths out of what's there. But if you'll notice, a little bit of a tweak came out this week about rare earths. We knew this well over 3 years ago. And now Obama says we're going to have to ask China to forgive some of these rare earths. China's policy is fixed. If you want to build that kind of equipment, you come over here, you can build it. We will sell it to you. But you have to build it in China and use our people. That's a serious problem.
Follow up on the China situation, you're absolutely right. The war we're fighting today is the war on terrorism. However, as an aside, Obama has mentioned he's turning his military eye to China. And the reason he's turning his military eye to China is they have just launched their first aircraft carrier. They have built many submarines. They are building a huge navy, and the purpose of the navy is to be in the Yellow Sea. Most of our friends, if you're familiar with the Philippines, the Japanese, South Korea, the Malaysians, all that trade is done in that area. What China's doing is going to build up a Navy that's strong enough to keep our aircraft carriers out. They can then go into Taiwan also. So we may be fighting a terrorism war today, but in a not too far future, we're going to be fighting another big war with airplanes and aircraft carriers and so forth. So you can't just keep a military for the war you're building, not that we're fighting now. You've got to keep a military ready for the future war, which is just over the horizon today with China.
Yeah, I just want to say something addressed to what Harry had said before. You gave many reasons why we shouldn't be the policemen to the world and whatever. But one of the things you left out that's very important is that we should be supporters of our allies. Not necessarily with manpower, but in other means for our trusted allies.
Okay.
Doing well.
I mean, I don't know about you, but I think this is a really interesting way to do this thing. What do you guys think? Yeah. I gotta tell you, I was worried because I know many of these panelists, in fact, all of them, and they're all getting around with me saying they weren't prepared at all. They were gonna wing it, and almost everybody's got notes in front of them and are really answering within the guidelines and really well. So thank you. On to the next subject. Mona, what would you like to talk about?
I can't say mixed company.
What about the subject of a balanced budget and taxes?
That's so boring.
It's really boring. So, you drink let's again? See.
Help me again.
Oh, no.
Very simply, there could be no recovery without an increase in revenue. You can cut services, you can go on austerity like crazy. That doesn't solve the problem. You have to raise revenue somehow. A perfect example is Greece, who they've cut programs there. Their austerity is wicked. Pension is like 50% gone, so on and so forth. And Greece is not doing any of that because nobody's putting any money in their account. So, some cuts, fine, but you've got to raise revenue also.
Larry?
I have some facts here. This is the budget proposed by our president, this administration, excuse me. In his budget, he wants to increase the dividend tax rate to 43%, the capital gains rate to 23%, income approximately 40%. And he says by doing this, we'll get over a 10-year period of time, $206 billion. Now, the fact is, that's 10 years, so that's $20 billion a year. Do you know how much we spend per day in our government? $10 billion. So it would pay for 2 days of our budget. That's what his taxes are going to do. There's another fact I have, is that if you take every single penny that anybody earns over $250,000, and all the income of the Fortune 500 companies, all the assets of the income producers over $250,000, okay? All of that will cover, and so there's nothing left for anybody, that'll cover 1 year of a budget, which we have right now. One other little thought. By raising taxes, if one person who is a multimillionaire who was going to buy a yacht have it built in South Florida and decides not to because the taxes are a little higher, 1,000 jobs are going to be lost as a result of that one decision. Now, the only way that we can get out of our mess is you're not going to get it by raising taxes and like you're going to get it. The only way you can do it is by cutting the budget significantly.
Can you give us two or three cuts you would make?
I would lower the tax rates to encourage business. I would eliminate right now in the last 3 years the rate. regulations that have been put on business. There are 10,215 new regulations, which cost $46 billion. What's happening is American companies are very unsure about what's going to happen, and they're hoarding cash because they don't know what's going to happen. If they were given the thing that we're, taxes aren't going to be high, we're going to give you an incentive to go out and produce, we're going to give you incentives to manufacture products in the United States, business will do much, much better. And it's always been a proven fact that when taxes are lowered, revenue goes up. Very simple.
Just one point I want to add. Is that the budget has not been passed for a thousand days.
Howard, one moment, please. He set us up in a rotation.
Oh, he did. Okay.
Yes, go ahead, Howard.
Just to repeat myself, if you didn't hear, a budget has not been passed for 1,000 days already. And they just can't get, Congress and the President just can't get together with that.
Okay. How many of you, and we know already the answer, that they'll make money somewhere today, this year, your entire life, you've donated money? Why didn't you donate it to the government? Do you think that you would have got the same return on investment? My only thought process, we know that. We hear the Warren Buffetts of the world and others that are contributing billions of dollars in this factor, but they choose not to give it to our government. I believe, from where I stand, where I sit, the first thing we want to see from the people that we elect is they go in and get the fat, just like we do at our home when we don't have the same amount of money that we had last year. We go in and we do what we need to do. Then if we need more money, what do? We go to work, part-time, full-time, two jobs, whatever it takes. That's what I would call additional taxes going forward. But the first thing I think we want to see from our leaders is some honesty and integrity and following what we want them to do. Get out the waste, and then wherever the taxes should be for what we vote for, if we vote for medical, for everybody in a certain format, not Nancy Pelosi, 2,300 pages behind the scenes. Even the president did not know what was in it. We know that. Or whether it be for the safety of our country, we vote for that. But let's don't give them any more money until they prove us that they can manage what they have.
I just want to mention that, Larry, I certainly agree with you on the regulations. And I know I did read that Obama's created, his administration created four times as many as 3 years as George Bush did in 8. However, we have areas which we've seen, the recent MF Global situation, Arthur Anderson, of course, accountants regulated themselves. We saw what happened with Evan Enron. We just saw what happened with the 2008, the whole financial debacle. So there is a point where regulation is necessary. Also, I feel that examples taking place within companies of where the money goes. For example, the hedge fund chairman who's bankrupt in Sears, they closed 1,200 stores, left tons and tons of people, pays 14% in taxes, and then he buys a $40 million house over in New Creek in Miami. We see that today in the paper, in USA Today, the American Express CEO, who gets a $22 million a year salary plus another $7 or $8 million a year stock options, also gets a $365,000 allowance, just for incidentals. So this is where some of the money goes to these companies. So until these companies show that they're capable of running themselves with some compliance, yesterday Goldman Sachs, one of the executive directors of True All Saw this quit. And he had a tirade in the papers about Goldman Sachs, how it's excess and greed, they don't care at all about the clients, and in fact they refer to the clients as Muppets. And this is what's happening with some of these companies. So until people have the confidence of how these companies are going to operate, you know, we have some real issues there. Now the money sitting overseas, very critical, as Larry mentioned, there's God, it was close to $1 trillion without a company sitting overseas, and they're hiring people overseas. We need some kind of tax amnesty, on the other hand, to get that money back and also make it so that the money comes back if they hire Americans to do the job.
The gentleman to my right, down below, he's talking about facts, maybe facts he's made up, but I'm not asleep here, I do have notes. Republicans have been living forever on supply side effect. This is what they've been pushing constantly. Cut taxes because taxes pay for themselves. This is all you hear. Empirical evidence shows this is false. False, false, false. The two largest tax increases in the deficit in U.S. history, follow Reagan and Bush II in their tax cuts. Tax cuts will pay for themselves. The largest increases in our deficit follow these two brilliant statements. Brilliant statements. So let's not make up facts. Let's talk about facts. Because the Republican tax cuts just move money around. Move it here, move it there. And our kids have got to pay the interest on these plans that have not worked. The net effect is not a tax cut at all, but an increase in government spending increases GDP when spent on, the only way it works if it's spent on infrastructure. So he's completely wrong.
I'd like to point out, with regard to taxes, let's look at what happened and where we were at with one of the deepest deficits this country has ever faced in history, its history. Just take a look back at the concept of outsourcing and what happened. The outsourcing was a great idea. We all studied economics in college, and yes, the bottom line would be much helped if you go to a less expensive labor source. However, now we're buying the products back, bringing them back to be bought and sold here. And what happened here? Well, finally we ran out of money. But we had to make it easy to keep buying these products back. So what did we do? Years ago, we started with what was called home loans to get some money to buy back. Then we would put stuff on credit cards, and we had subprime, all of which finally petered out. There wasn't the money. Now, we were in very deep debt. Let me just read this by the greatest conservative, Thomas Jefferson, who was also very compassionate. And this is what he said, his historic words on debt. We must not let our rulers load us with perpetual debt. We must make our election between economy and liberty, or profusion and servitude. If we run into such debt as that, we must be taxed in our meat and in our drink and in our necessaries and our comforts, in our labors and our amusements, for our calling and our creeds. We will have no time to think, no means of calling our mismanagers to account, but be glad to obtain subsistence by hiring ourselves, rivet their chains on the necks of our fellow sufferers. And this is the tendency of all human governments. A departure from principle in one instance becomes a precedent for another, till the bulk of society is reduced to mere automatons of misery. And the fourth force of this team is public debt. Taxation follows that, and in its train, unfortunately, wretchedness and oppression. So let's stay out of that.
Someone before said that we were putting ourselves at the, technically, that we were putting ourselves at the mercy of the Chinese. Because at some point they're going to be able to outmaneuver us regarding areas strategically in Southeast Asia. Well, technically we're at a disadvantage. I very much agree, and this whole conversation regarding budget puts us at a disadvantage because we're at the mercy of the Chinese right now because they own all our debt. And we've got to reduce the deficit. We can't continue to create
this nanny state that we have been creating and have talked about income distribution and put ourselves in a position where we are creating individuals and people who are just looking for handouts.
One thing, Thomas Jefferson was just quoted, you know, we talk about the history and how it often repeats itself, but Thomas Jefferson said that the capital is politics. Now that hasn't changed. We have Republicans and the Democrats right now, and unfortunately the system is amazing that Republicans have to vote one way, because if they don't, and Democrats the same way, if they don't, then their party's going to put someone up against them and support that person, or they're not going to get a committee appointment. So as John's been talking constantly, where does the public come into play? And then they get reelected time after time. One thing I'd like to cover, though, unfair tax system. Right now, our system, there is something wrong, and Buffett pointed out that his tax rate is about 15%, his secretary 30%, a Republican candidate we know is in a similar situation with his secretary. There are entitlements. People talk only about the benefits to the poor from the entitlements, but then there are tax breaks that amount to approximately $1 trillion a year. $1 trillion a year that benefit the wealthy. Most of that money goes to benefit those entitlements, not entitlements, tax breaks go to benefit the wealthy. So we need to do something about our tax system. And I think that if we look at it, we may find ways to improve upon it and make it much fairer. But the way it exists now is totally inappropriate. And it's based on so many things like getting reelected to office. I think it was great that in most cities, it was nonpartisan. You didn't have a party looking over your shoulder and telling you, this is the way you vote, you won't get reelected. It was nonpartisan. I really question what the benefit of having two parties when they don't get together and vote.
Okay, we're going to take a commercial break, except it's not a commercial. It really is a pleasure and a privilege. Many of you have not met my heroes, Spalter, who has been so kind as to give us this magnificent facility to use. And he asked for some time to have a little bit of a discussion with you, and please welcome him and thank him very much.
Thank you very much, Larry. First of all, do me a favor, don't raise my taxes. I'm going right here. I'm not going to take much of your time. I just want to thank Larry for, on behalf of everyone, for organizing this wonderful event. I believe it's the second one already. I don't know how many more there will be, but the more the merrier. But I just want to give you 2 minutes of a background on how this came about. Larry and myself and a number of other individuals in this room sitting here tonight have become very close over the last several years, some more, probably going back 15 years with him and Harry and myself. We started a get-together where we talk hot topics every Wednesday at 12 o'clock. Those are the real hot topics. And I want to invite you all to try it once, to come here for lunch and learn. The men and the women that come have a fantastic time, and it's good for the body, it's good for the soul, or some would say it's not so good for the body, but it certainly is good for the soul. And I want to extend an invitation to all of you here. You don't have to be at any level of observance or knowledge or even faith or belief. Just, you have 2 feet, 2 hands, a little seichel, come right in. I just want to also give each one of you tonight our latest semester, a brochure that we give out on all the different programs that we do over here in terms of adult education. and they're at the table as you leave, and perhaps maybe I'll put them out on the table. But in here, it also we have different lecturers that come in. Not everyone with a beard, don't worry. And many different topics. Some of them hot, some of them cold, some of them media, you know, room temperature. But they're all interesting. And I encourage every one of you to take the opportunity to enjoy that which you have right here in town. And we offer every single week. Wednesday at 12, great lunch, great discussions, great people, and a very friendly environment. Thank you very much.
First of all, again, thank you very much, Rabbi Schulter. I will definitely support and recommend his suggestion. Lunch and Learn is really an experience for, I think there are a dozen of us who in this room who come. You know, if you do come to Lunch and Learn, why don't you stand up for a second so you can see who's around.
Get a shot.
Come on, Howard. So you can see it's a cross section of our community. There are, for the women, there are several women who come in and out. The lunch is really quite good. It's sometimes boring because it's always the same. But the food's very good. The food is quite good. Howard will attest to the cookies. Howard's our cookie expert. But in any event, really, I mean, it's not a major request from the rabbi. I think it's something that would really benefit you if you came. We currently have about a dozen people who come every week, and there's plenty of room for more. So we've gone an hour and a half. It seems to me it was pretty quick. I don't know, maybe some of you don't think it was so quick. But first and foremost, I want to thank our panel. I thought they did an excellent job. They obviously prepared. They listened to the guidelines. They didn't speak forever. Their point was right to the point, and they did a great job. So thank you all very much for doing that. The next meeting is now open for discussion. You recall in November we had probably the most well-attended, fabulous Mark Eiglarsh. Spoke about what it was to be a criminal attorney. He gave us anecdotes, he told us funny stories, he gave us tremendous insight into what it was like to be an attorney. And many of you, in fact, I think most of the people who were there wanted to have more.
Yes.
So it's 5 months since Mark has talked to us. Mark has agreed to come back. The question is when. Our next meeting is scheduled for April the 5th, but his mother tells me that it's the night before Passover for those who observe. So that is one possibility. The other possibility is also made available the next Thursday, which is April the 12th. Well, it is the second, but he originally committed to the first one. So he has been flexible enough to say April the 12th. Just by a quick show of hands, how many people would prefer April the 5th?
None.
One. Bert? Sorry. How many would prefer April the 12th? Okay, Dorothy, we need to tell Mark. So it will again be here at 7:30.
April the Passover.
What?
I think it's still Passover. I think it's the end days.
It is, but I think it, well, where's the rabbi?
It's Sunday.
It's after Sunday.
Yeah.
You know what? I'll let you know by email if it's a problem, but I think we should be okay.
No problem. What about Dorothy, though?
No, Dorothy doesn't have a problem. I would anticipate we'll probably have well over 100 people in the room. Just by way of quick feedback, we will do this through May. We'll do it again. We'll have two more meetings, and they'll be here. Midtown keeps threatening that they're going to open up their cafe.
Yeah, right. We'll have a budget before then.
But in any event, are there any topics that you would like to think about or discussion points for the meeting in May? Or should we just kind of wait until Mark? Oh, yes, no. Harry.
While we're thinking about a topic, I think it would be fitting and appropriate that we give a round of applause to Larry Rothman. Yay!
And Joy wrote for publicizing this to the rest of the Western community. So, with that in mind, anybody have any topics they want to bring up, or we'll just do it by email? Everyone has gotten my email, correct? You're all on my list. Okay. So then, you're not. When you come see me. Oh, you have a question? Yes.
Since all the discussions tonight, it was all very interesting. I agree and disagree with many things. But the one thing that was absolutely, to me, the most important thing was all of the complaints that everybody has about how our Congress is fighting with each other. What can we actually do? You all say we should do. What can we do?
If they're in office, they vote them out.
They all lie. Yes.
Vote them out.
You know, actually, our Congress is much more civil today than it was in the 1800s. In the 1800s, they take sticks and they beat each other up. Maybe we need them.
Well, with that anyway, let's bring the meeting to an end. Thank you, Rachel, for the trust. You can thank the chairs.
That's all, folks.